reverse thing going on. I wonder why that happened. If I was clever, I'd be able to switch the swing now, but I can't. Well, you know, just print.
Yeah, that's really strange.
Oh, well. Yeah,
it's like,
So is that all?
Okay, we're going to make a start. So, thank you all for coming, and I'm very excited to introduce Robin Dean, who has made it back from America after quite a hazardous adventure, I think it could be described as. Robin has been a practitioner in ASL interpreting for 25 years, particularly in the field of healthcare. And she's also on the faculty at University of Rochester in New York, yes. And also the National Technical Institute for the Deaf. And she has been doing her PhD at Heriot-Watt University, and she's just finishing it off now, and she'll be defending it in June. That's the title up there, which she's going to be talking about today, the Sign Language Interpreter's Ethical Discourse and Moral Reasoning. And so I'm very excited to hand over to Robin. We do have the live stream working, but it's a little bit dark, but it's what we managed to do. And we also want to particularly thank our one volunteer interpreter for tonight, Bon. Thanks so much for your stuff. And also, just to let you know for your diary, the next EdSign lecture, the last one of this academic year, will be on the 12th of May, and that will be Paddy Lad, who is coming to talk about deaf pedagogy. Never pronounce that one. And that one will also have an electronic note taker doing image to screen as well. A ring and also obviously the SL interpreter. Thank you very much. Over to the wonderful. So it's a little bit of a circle of life thing tonight, because when I first arrived 3 years ago on the PhD scholarship that I came to Harriet Watt on under Graham Turner and spending a fair amount of time, I did an EdSign lecture when I first got here in November. And here I am at the end of my PhD, and the person who interpreted for me was Yvonne, and that was the first time I met Yvonne. And so here we are, sort of at the end of my PhD, so it's a bit of a sort of momentous occasion to be sort of circle of life and sort of closing this thing. Here we are together again. But this time we know each other a lot better than we did before. So I'm going to be telling you my about my PhD and a section of my data from my PhD. The title is Sign Language Interpreters, Ethical Discourse and Moral Reasoning Patterns. And just as a reminder, Graham, Svenja, and Brian Napier came on as a third supervisor to my PhD about a year into it, year and a half into it. And so many thanks to them for their work. As Ella mentioned, I recently have taken a faculty position at the Rochester Institute of Technology, or NTID. And I was in a staff meeting recently, and one of the faculty members was upset by a conversation that she had had in one of her classes and was bringing it to the staff meeting to sort of complain to her fellow staff members about the problems of dealing with students. And one of the things that they were talking about was, how do you decide, as a newer interpreter, how do you decide what types of jobs you should take and what types of interpreting jobs as a freelance interpreter that you should not take? It's a good question to ask yourself as you're starting to find your way out as a newer interpreter to decide whether or not you can take a job. So that question was on the table in her class. And one student responded by saying, well, what I'm really concerned about when I decide to take a job or not take a job is really about to what degree I would be suitable for that deaf individual for that assignment. To what degree would I have an impact? Would I be qualified or not qualified, etc.? And so this one particular student was struggling with the decision about whether or not you decide to take an assignment based on whether or not your work would be impactful in a negative way on the deaf people and the hearing people that you're interpreting for. So that was sort of the topic of conversation, and she turned to another student. How is it that you decide whether or not to take freelance work, to take an assignment or not take an assignment? And his response was, just depends on if it fits in my schedule or not. And in the room, when she said that, everybody did this sort of, oh, jeez, oh. And I thought to myself, that's just like what my PhD is about, is that we all have this internal, intuitive reaction to moral reasoning skills, and we decide that one is superior to another. But how do we know that? Why is it that we all think that the guy who says whether or not it fits into my schedule, why is that less sophisticated or less honorable than somebody who says, well, I wonder about these things and these things and these things? Well, it turns out we have research and theories into the hierarchy of moral reasoning. And to give you sort of a heads up, in that theory, which I'm going to explain to you, but just as a heads up, we would call what this person is doing, what the female student said, as reasoning through principles. And what the male student did by this reasoning was to reason via personal interest. How does this impact me? How is this going to fit into my schedule? And they're hierarchically different. So as I was saying, saying you and I sort of intuitively respond, or sort of at a gut reaction, respond to the differences in what is a good reason to do something and what is not a good reason to do something. And there's, like I said, research and theories behind those different ways of thinking about how you and I should choose to cooperate with one another. Like the male student who suggested I look at my schedule and decide whether or not a job fits, I refer to him as having something reasoning through personal interest. And the kinds of questions that an individual who's reasoning using personal interest would say is, what's in it for me? An individual who is concerned about rules, who says, well, I decide to take freelance jobs based on whether or not my supervisor says I can, would be reasoning or thinking that the best way to cooperate with individuals is through the ideals of maintaining norms. That is, what is my duty? What does the rule say? And that's what I do. And the third and highest, most sophisticated form of ethical reasoning is referred to as principled or post-conventional reasoning. And the person who is reasoning in this capacity asks themselves questions such as, what ideals are shared? How can those shared ideals be operationalized in this decision? And how can I cooperate or collaborate with folks? So the student, the female student who answered, I wonder about the deaf individual. Obviously, the deaf individual wants to make sure he or she has a good interpreter. And the hearing individual wants to make sure they have a good interpreter. And she wants to be a good interpreter for that setting. And so those ideals are shared between all parties. And that's referred to as principled reasoning. You can't have a presentation on your PhD research without showing them, the audience, what your PhD research questions are. So basically, these are my three questions, the third one being rather the most important one. The first is, given the sign language interpreter's ethical discourse, what can be understood about their adherence to or disagreement with the profession's normative ethical ideals? So basically, if you look at sort of what we tend to say in interpreting as what is ethical, to what degree when interpreters talk about making ethical decisions, are those in accordance with those normative messages? The second question is, in light of that ethical discourse of sign language interpreters, what can be inferred about whether or not they're pulling from personal interest? Are they pulling from maintaining norms? Or are they reasoning in a principled way? Or are there other psychological components going on that impacts how it is they reason and make decisions? And the final question, is there evidence that our profession, sign language interpreting's profession's conceptualization of ethics and the way we reason through decisions is really commensurate with post-conventional reasoning? Could we say that the way we talk about ethics is actually as sophisticated as it could be based on what it is we know to be hierarchically sound in terms of ethical reasoning? All of these different ways of thinking about how I am going to behave with other people, social cooperation, is based in the ideals of justice. What is the just, right thing to do? There happens to be a story that most of you are probably familiar with that deals in several different ways with the theme of justice. And interestingly enough, there are particularly three characters who represent each one of these types of ethical reasoning schemes quite well. And
And I thought that instead of me trying to rattle off the names of each one of these ethical reasoning approaches, it would be helpful for an audience who's not familiar with the theory that I've actually been engaging in for several years to understand it in a, I think, much more identifiable way. So I've chosen a clip I'm going to show you from the movie. Unfortunately, there's no way of capturing the, perhaps, Broadway or London show, but okay. So I'm going to catch the clip, give you a clip of the movie that shows all three characters interacting with these different ways of perceiving justice, these different ways of perceiving what's right, what is the right thing to do. Let me give you a quick synopsis of before the scene begins, or for those of you who are not familiar with the story of Les Mis, let me give you just sort of a quick idea. So the first character name that I'm going to introduce is Valjean. He's sort of the main character. And he's been arrested at the start of the play and movie and put in prison for stealing bread that he stole because his nephew was starving. And he was put in jail for 20 years for stealing bread for his starving nephew. He's arrested and supervised by the second character called Javert. And during the 20 years and during his parole period, Javert is sort of following him about, making sure that he sticks with what it is he's supposed to be doing, both either in prison or during his parole time. Just at the start of this clip that I'm going to show you, Valjean has found that his living life as an ex-convict is very difficult. He's finding things to be quite unfair, but he's shown mercy by the character of the bishop, and his life is forever changed. And so the Valjean that we know throughout the majority of the play or movie of Les Mis is actually a very different character than when we first meet him. But I'm going to actually show you a clip of when he is still at that place of trying to deal with life on life's terms as an ex-convict. And we have checked out to make sure that the video will work and the sound will work. It's captioned, so there won't be any interpreting. And we'll make sure that it's as light as it can be, but if you've ever seen the movie, it's a very dark movie, and so it can be sometimes hard to see the characters.
A volcano. Valjean as a dangerous man who will be on parole forever. Failure to report means immediate arrest, being retaliated.
So this character that you just see leaving is Valjean.
Have you seen the bankers? Bankers? Sleeping stable, please. Yeah.
This
is the bishop.
Our lives are very humble. We have, we share. There is wine here to provide you. There is bread to make you strong. A bed to rest in the morning, rest from pain, and rest from the morning. Bless the food we eat today, bless our dear sister, and our good guest.
Let me just pause it to give you sort of a rundown. So he's brought into the bishop's convent house, taken care of, and when everybody is asleep, he steals all the silver. And while in the next scene you don't see Javert, who you do see are Javert's staff who have found him.
Cut down! Stay there! What's in your... We have your silver. We caught this man red-handed.
He doesn't have to say you gave him this.
That is right. But my friend, you left silver out of it. Surely something slipped your mind.
Forgot.
I gave these also. Leave the best behind.
As you look, please, this man has spoken the truth.
I commend you for your duty. Our Lord's blessing grows. But remember this, my brother. You must somehow your plan. You must use this precious silver to become an honest man. By the richness of the martyrs, by the passion and the blood, God has raised you out of darkness. I have saved.
So as you can see, Valjean is looking out for himself. Life as an ex-con has been difficult. He's desperate, and that desperation leads him to see that there's an opportunity. He takes that opportunity and steals from the bishop, even though the bishop has provided him a place to stay and food, etc. He's caught by the guards, who think that justice needs to happen through everybody following the rules, and when you steal from people, you have to pay the price. The bishop, in his post-conventional, conventional being sort of the way you follow the rules, you do what you're supposed to do, but the post-conventional thinker recognizes that while conventions are important, rules are important, oftentimes rules favor the powerful and favor the majority, and they do not allow for oftentimes, well, in many instances, for justice to be done the way the rule was originally conceived of. And so even though he had lied and said, and the bishop, being a religious figure, lies to the police and says, oh no, no, I did give him the silver. As a matter of fact, I gave him all the silver and he didn't even take these other bits. And so here you go. And he says, now you can release him because he's told you the truth. So he breaks the rules himself to allow for what the bishop imagines as a higher purpose. And it's from there on that the hero of our story, Valjean, or yes, Jean Valjean, takes on a very different character because of that instance. Because of that personal interest schema, what's in it for me, how can I look out for number one, meets up with post-conventional reasoning. How can I do what is right? And from there on out, we would call him Valjean 2.0, if you will. He becomes a very different person, and he takes on the character of the bishop in his post-conventional thinking and post-conventional reasoning. And then throughout, if you're familiar with the story, Javert, the maintaining norms guy, interacts with post-conventional reasoning guy for the rest of the show. And of course, at the end of the day, maintaining norms guy kills himself. But that's the end of the show. So that's all to suggest that we as people reason through our decisions and decide what is just, what is right in different ways. And I'm going to, as I've introduced Valjean 1.0, Javert and the Bishop, I'm going to now tell you, what does this have to do with interpreting? That leads us into a conversation about moral psychology, and that is why it is people make decisions. How it is they come to imagine and think about right action. It was actually David Hume who said that reason is a slave to the passions. And that is, in essence, we make decisions based on what we want to do and what we don't want to do. And moral psychology would agree with him. And he would say that what we do is that we come along after we've made a decision based on what we want to do or don't want to do, and we use all sorts of reasoning to kind of tie it up and defend why that was a good decision. These ways of thinking about what is just and what is right, or how we get to right action, was conceived of by a researcher called James Rest. These moral schemas were proposed as the three moral schemas that we all have functioning within our decision-making processes. And it's not as if we never think in a personal interest way. We're always here, or the post-conventional, most advanced. We actually think and use all of these in a very tacit process. That is a process that's beyond our awareness. Certain situations tap for us or activate for us a certain reaction that we then reason through using one of these moral schemas. We get to a point in our life, says the theorists and the researchers within the field of moral psychology, we get to a point in our life where we have preferences for one or the other, that one is more dominant than another. So all of us will, if we, for example, like Valjean, when put in a place where we are desperate or we are in a survival mode, we will be thinking in a personal interest way. We will be reasoning through in a personal interest way. As a teacher, if a student comes up to you and says, oh, I'm sorry, I know I was supposed to turn in my assignment on such and such a date, but it's late, is there any way you can, and the teacher, you say, no, sorry. Everybody is supposed to follow these guidelines, you need to stick with the guidelines. That would be activating a maintaining norms schema, okay? Whereas somebody else would reason, a teacher may very well reason based on some other approach in saying, well, okay, perhaps in this given situation, I'm gonna let this slide. So we all have the capacity and we all reason in these ways. What I want to do next is share with you some features about each one of these schemas. And I'm not going to spend too much time talking about all of them. I might pick out a few. But the point of these is to kind of just give you a taste, to fully kind of flesh out what these ways of thinking and ways of acting look like. Personal interest is usually an arbitrary, compulsive cooperation. Go along with the group, if you will. Self-focused, advantage to self as primary, survival orientation, responsibility orientation, this sense of if I don't do it, who else will? Sort of this sense of almost like a hero or heroine type approach. It's my duty, no, really, I'll do it, okay? Scope includes others who are known. So certainly you can think about what's in it for me or what's in it for the people that I know and love or are closest to me. Okay? In-group reciprocity. I want the people in my group to benefit and less concerned about those who are external. The maintaining norms schema, or our character of Javert, is the recognition that we need norms, we need rules, we need to make sure that people just are not out there doing whatever it is they think is best for them, because other people will be hurt by that. So we need to make sure we have rules. Society-wide view, right, kind of broaden beyond the self and beyond the in-group. Uniform categorical application, that is, I don't care about your reasoning for why you turned in your homework late. The rule is applied uniformly in every situation. Partial society-wide reciprocity, that is, the people for whom the rules often work for anyway, they're the ones that usually benefit from this approach. And duty, what is my duty or my job? So then there's post-conventional schema features. These are people who try to think about what are the ideals, ethical and moral ideals here. How are my ideals shareable with another person? Or in what ways is what this person wants and what I want shareable, and we can capitalize on that component that we share, even though we might not share everything in common. Primacy of the moral ideal, full reciprocity, and rights orientation. So James Rest decided that he was going to create an instrument that would measure to what degree people use personal interest, maintaining norms, or post-conventional thinking. It's called the defining issues test. It's been in existence since the late 1970s, and they've been collecting data on that since then, and they've amassed quite a large database from which they've been able to derive normative data, like how do typical 16-year-olds respond to this test, or what kinds of ways do they think? Which one of these do they find the most appealing when they reason through scenarios? The Center for the Study of Ethical Development is what James Rest founded with the DIT. You are allowed to administer the test yourself as a researcher, but you cannot score it. You have to submit it to them to be scored, to pay to have it scored, which allows them to amass all of this data so that they have some database that they can then derive norms from. The idea behind it is that it's designed to measure how it is you tend to think as an individual. Which one of these do you use the most in your reasoning? And they provide you with, and it's changed over the years, right now the current version of the DIT, which is the second version, has 5 ethical scenarios. And the hypothesis is behind it that this is how you tend to make decisions in your life in general, that is generalizable to how you make decisions as an individual, what you're compelled by. So there are 5 scenarios that are offered, all of which in these 5 scenarios of the DIT are of a macro morality level. So such as, how should society get along? How should one cooperate in this situation? It's not meant to be sort of individual people. It's meant to have implications for wider society. So each one of the scenarios has to do with the wider society. After the scenario is presented to you as a respondent of the DIT, it asks a judgment question. Should the character in this scenario take action, don't take action, or can't decide? Okay, so at the very start, 5 scenarios, each one of them has what's referred to as the judgment question. What action should be taken? Then, after you decide what you think is the right action, You then have to rate 12 argumentation statements on a scale from great importance to no importance. So you read the argumentation and you say, yes, that's a really good reason why I think this person should X. And then you say, so that's great importance. And then you'll read another one and you'll say, eh, I can see that, but it doesn't have the same validity as the other, so I'll give it some importance, et cetera, et cetera, all the way through 12 argumentation statements. And then the third and final question type for each scenario is a ranking of the top four reasonings that you think are the most compelling reasons why you think, or why you would imagine that would be the right action. Right? There have been extensive, because they've been able to amass such a database, there have been extensive validity studies. They've been able to show that people make longitudinal gains over years of experience, life experience, as well as education. They've been able to show that within education groups, people cluster around a certain way of thinking, and that with more education, people advance in their thinking in terms of what argumentations they're more compelled by. The DIT has three measures. The first one is called the P-score, or the principled reasoning, and that is the degree to which a person will both rate and rank those argumentations that show personal interests type things, such as appeals to ideals and full reciprocity, etc. So these statements, argumentation statements, all sort of pull towards that, towards post-conventional. And then if you have other argumentations that are, well, the rule says such and such, and so you should do that, and you've rated that high and ranked it high, then you will be shown to have more of a maintaining norm schema, and the same thing for personal interest. But it mostly looks at to what degree, from a comparative standpoint, you think in a post-conventional way. Okay, the most sophisticated way of thinking. Your type indicator, which I'm not going to go into for my data, I'm just going to tell you the P-score data and use that as an explanation. The type indicator is a more of a holistic profile. So maybe your P-score wasn't high, but maybe your P-score and your maintaining norm score were kind of similar. And so you show that you have sort of a preference for both of those. Okay, so it can show you sort of a more three-dimensional view of the individual respondent. And the utilizer score is a score that looks at to what degree your judgment, whether or not you think the person, the character in the story, should take action or not take action, coincides with your argumentation. So if you say he should not take action, but then you give a bunch of arguments that actually push towards yes, taking action, then there's something conflicting about your reasoning. Right, so it's a validity concern that you are sort of, you make a decision, but then you're kind of compelled in a different way. So my sample is a group of American Sign Language interpreters. There were 25 altogether. These are here just some sort of demographics about them. About half graduated from a two-year program in interpreting. About 36% did not. About half of them went on to have four-year degrees. About a third of them didn't have a degree. All were certified with the exception of one individual. The average age of experience was 14 years, and the average age was 49. Only 22 people responded to that question. So while I would say that basically those demographics are not particularly interesting, sounds like sort of a okay, run-of-the-mill group of individuals. The age is a bit unique that we would have that high of an age in this cohort. Just a note that because I've not published this data, I would rather you not publish it before me. So if you are planning on writing an article, though I'm sure none of you are, about this presentation, it would be helpful if you don't, because I don't want to cite you when I publish my data. So this information should not be shared in any publication form. So what I'm going to show you, and I'll have to do a little bit of interpretation. Can I step out of the frame to get to there? I'm going to explain sort of the education level, because this is based on sort of American education standards and how it is we do grade levels, etc. But what I'm going to show you is sort of grade level and then the different scores and how those different scores for my group of sign language interpreters compared to the normative database that they have. All right. So grades 7 through 9 is sort of end of primary school, beginning of secondary school. All right, so that's what, 14, 12, yep, 11, 12, that age. Grade 10 is about 15 to senior, final year in secondary school, or what we call high school. And then we have first year undergrad, fourth year undergrad, and then master's degree at the bottom. So here are the scores, if you see them, sort of the grade 7 through 9, for personal interest. Okay? And the sign language interpreting cohort that I measured were thinking similarly in the personal interest way, like freshmen in college, just starting university. Right? And then in the maintaining norms way of thinking, they were actually much younger. They thought more like students who were 14 years old and younger, 14 to 12 perhaps. And then with personal interest, post-conventional thinking, they were similar to they were with personal interest, which is around just starting university, so age 18, 19-ish years old. So that's quite younger than they actually are. Now, if we look at the P scores of different groups, so we looked at, in this last one, we compared them to sort of age and education. But then we go on to professional education. And where do other professional education folks look like? So people who, of course, major in philosophy and political science would, as you would imagine, score the highest on this test because they think about moral issues and political issues all the time. And as you can see, they have the highest score. And then law students, medical students, practicing physicians. And so you see sort of where all these folks tend to cluster in terms of their P score. How, to what degree do they think in post-conventional reasoning? Adults in general get a 40 on post-conventional reasoning, but the sign language interpreting sample didn't even make the professional level group. As a matter of fact, they were closer to looking like seniors in high school than they were looking like other professional individuals. Now, this is concerning on lots of levels. One level is that for many of us as sign language interpreters, we work with these folks. And so if our ethical moral reasoning skills are substandard, it's going to be very difficult to have any sort of interdisciplinary collaborative dialogue if the level of reasoning is at completely different places. And as you can see from these scores, their maintaining norm score was the most dominant, right? That's the rule, this is the rule, this is what I do, period. Okay. So you may wonder where I got this group of 25 from. Well, I will tell you, because I actually had quite a lot of data on this group already. This respondent cohort participated in an online webinar that was offered in the US by some agency on how to apply the ethical code of our professional organization to scenarios, to situations. And before they were to show up on the day of the online webinar, they had to submit homework. where they were provided 13 different scenarios and asked to answer a series of questions about those scenarios. So in essence, what I had was, instead of a macro morality version of the DIT, if you will, I had kind of a micro morality where they were looking at interpreting specific scenarios and answering what would you do and why would you do it, which is not too dissimilar from the DIT. So I found that to be an interesting opportunity to use the DIT in light of the fact that I had their homework to look at and use as a comparable source. So let me go ahead and sort of compare the types of material between the DIT and the homework that I had. There were five ethical scenarios, as I mentioned, in the DIT, dealing with macro morality topics. I took their 13 scenarios and, using exclusion-inclusion criteria, brought it down to 6. And those were, of course, were of the micro morality or specific to interpreting level. The DIT is quantitative, so it's sort of closed answer. You don't have the opportunity to self-produce any material. You only recognize and tick off what you feel is commensurate with your way of thinking. You rate and rank them. The homework, there was no opportunity for rating and ranking. It was all just sort of self-produced material. What do you think is the right thing to do? And there were stimulus questions, and I'll tell you what those stimulus questions were. And of course, the DIT is sent off to the Center for Study of Ethical Development in the US, and I use my own interpretive analysis to decide whether or not, you know, where, how it is they were thinking about ethical scenarios. So that's sort of the two data sources that I have on this same group of 25. So here's an example of a scenario that they were given. This says, you are called to interpret for a terminally ill patient and his family members at a family meeting comprising of a team of medical and health professionals who are caring for the patient. Some family members pull you aside before entering the room and expressly ask you not to mention the word cancer in your interpretation, but to refer to it vaguely as an illness. So the questions that they were supposed to answer is, what would you choose to do in this situation? What is the potential impact of that choice or action? What is the potential impact if you choose to do nothing at all, which was always interpreted as, what if you chose not to do what you said was the right thing to do, as opposed to just standing perfectly still, to doing nothing at all? In essence, people interpreted it to mean, if I didn't do this other thing, I think is right. And what cultural information needs to be shared, and how would you present it? So in order to make these two data sources, the DIT that looks at these ethical scenarios and looks at the way they reason through using personal interest schema, maintaining norm schema, and post-conventional schema, I decided to look at their homework responses through that lens. To what degree are the statements that they're making sounding like they're concerned about themselves? Are they concerned about the rules? Or are they concerned about the people in the situation? And then I would code it based on which one of those it seemed reflective of, so that I could compare from a macro level of analysis and a micro or interpreting specific level. So let me give you an example of one person's responses. So the column over there, which is the furthest column to the left, you see 93 was the respondent number, okay? And you see A, B, C, D, D1, and D2. That corresponds with the questions of what would you do? What is the impact of that? Right, those four questions. So here's an example of a person's answers based on just my initial coding of breaking it down into those four categories. First, I would explain to the family member that I was hired to interpret everything that is said at the meeting to the patient. B, they said, if I do this, what's the impact? The deaf person will get the full story of the situation and will not be left out of this very critical meeting. What would happen if you didn't do that? I would be interpreting for the patient and the medical team would be in the dark as to what is happening within the family. If the family gets upset, the patient would most likely get upset. Okay, and then D is what kind of cultural information needs to be shared. And they said information to be shared is as my role as the interpreter, I have to interpret what is being said honestly and truthfully. I would suggest that the family member talk to the medical team about the request before the meeting. So hopefully as you're reading those, you're also getting the sense of, does that sound like a personal interest type of statement? Does that sound like a maintaining norms statement? Or does that sound post-conventional? And that's in essence how I ended up trying to code them. The first one is, well, first I would tell them that my job is to do this. Okay, they're not talking about consequences. They're not talking about what you and I share in common. They're talking about, here is my job. So that would have gotten the maintaining norms schema code. Now, the deaf person, the second one, the deaf person will get the full story of the situation and will not be left out of this very critical meeting. It sounds both post-conventional, aren't we concerned the deaf person's not, you know, getting access to information, but it also has that flavor of responsibility orientation that was a part of personal interest. Remember, I talked about this idea that if I do this thing will happen. This person will get the full story. They will understand what is happening. We have no idea about the cognitive functioning level of this deaf individual. We have no understanding of whether or not it's a child or an adult, etc. And yet they've decided that if they take this action, it's going to lead to them getting the full story. So it sounds either personal interest or post-conventional, depending on what they mean by what they're saying. So that led me to approach my data in a different way, which is to look at all of the responses and come up with prototypical statements like the DIT does. The DIT came up with 12 argumentation statements. So I looked at all of their data and came up with somewhere between 8 and 10 argumentation statements that seemed to be sort of the most popular ones, and then counted them. As if they had seen those, they would have ticked those boxes. And here are some examples. First one, the interpreter would be liable and may be sued if she alters the message. So what's that? Personal interest, concerned about the interpreter being sued. The family is likely to be angry at the interpreter if she denies their request. So again, I'm concerned about whether or not people are angry at me. Personal interest, yeah? The interpreter would be giving this deaf patient access to their true diagnosis. Again, that sense of direct connection. I'm making this thing happen without any sort of deliberation about how that's possible. Maintaining norm schema, the family and the medical team need to understand the role and ethics of the interpreter. The ethical code of the profession requires interpreters to always render the message faithfully. The medical team should be the ones addressing this request. The interpreter is not the right person to talk to. And the final maintaining norms one is interpreters always interpret everything as it is spoken and or signed. And then we had three post-conventional sounding type statements. Deaf people have a right to access information that impacts their health and a rights orientation. The impact of this choice on the family and the medical team and their ability to care for their patient should be considered. And the final one, the family's reason for this should be considered and included in the decision. And so what you see is that altogether, if you were to count how many responses fit into those basic categories, you can have, in essence, a quantitative version of this qualitative study by counting those statements. And you can see in the farthest right-hand column what those numbers turn out to be. Personal interest statements, there were about 23 people who altogether affirmed or compelled by personal interest. or MPEL in this case, maintain norm schema 50, and then personal post-conventional or principled reasoning was 17. So what I did, and not to take you through every single case, because that would take up way too much time and be terribly boring, but that's the way my last couple of years went. Here's what you get for the totals if you go through all six cases. When you mathematically divide out of 458 possible statements, the percentage of personal interest, maintaining norms, and post-conventional, here's what you get. Look to the right-hand column, 24% of personal interest statements, 44% of the maintaining norm statements, and 33% of the home, of the post-conventional or principled reasoning type. And then as you can see in the left-hand column, those are the responses, the percentages from the DIT. So pretty comparable, even though they're very different approaches, and certainly that's needing to be recognized. But it is interesting that there is this similar pattern, that they are very much compelled by, at the strongest point, right? They're much compelled by maintaining norms at the highest level. So what? Why do we care? Well, this is my truncated version of so what, because I've got two chapters of so what. But I'm going to give you only sort of what I'm particularly concerned about. We do know that there is patterns that emerge in interpreters' ethical discourse. It shows this preference for maintaining norms as sort of the dominant interpretive judgment strategy that they use. And it occurs both at the macro and micro level of reasoning. In my PhD, I explore that this probably has to do with the way we talk about ethics and the language that we have associated with it. That actually the language and the way in which we talk about ethics could be prohibiting us from actually being able to reveal decision making that is more advanced. It's not necessarily that they don't have the capacity to reason in those ways, it's that their ethical discourse is limited by the lexical choices that they have in what they're used to saying. And let me just give an example. If, and I'm trying to use the same example that you saw, so in the cancer situation, the terminally ill patient, if one, the typical response from interpreters was, it is my job to interpret everything, right? Sort of just that blanket, that's my job, I have no choice, please don't come talk to me, okay? That's a very different ethical reasoning than saying, I would be concerned that if I don't sign that, that the medical team isn't going to have access to that information, or that the deaf person isn't going to have access to that information. You could still be saying, I'm not going to be doing it, but the way you're reasoning through it, obviously in one instance, is more sophisticated. And not only is it sophisticated, more sophisticated in that hierarchical terms, but it also opens up the door for dialogue. Because if the interpreter were to say to the family in response, I would be concerned about the deaf person's access to their health care information, perhaps the family would say, oh no, they know they have cancer. I'm just letting you know that we signed that because of their whatever, age, because of their limited cognitive ability. We're just signing it this way. Oh, okay, so now my concern is responded to. And they may also have the opportunity to say, the medical team understands that this is what's happening. So the ethical reasoning is not just sophisticated from an opportunity of, you know, looking at it from a PhD perspective. If you're reasoning in a post-conventional way, you are opening up dialogue to allow for ideals to be shared or to be found out to be shared so that that dialogue can happen. If you merely say, that's the rule, that's my job, it closes discussion and it doesn't allow for collaboration, which is what post-conventional reasoning is most interested in, is how can we find shareable ideals. So part of my concern with interpreters and what this data means is that we're not allowing ourselves as professionals, by reasoning in these ways, to engage in dialogue with deaf people and hearing people that we work with to be able to decide how is it that we can collaborate in ways that bring about, again, what we all share as ideals. The second bullet point is, secondly, in their moral reasoning is a very strong personal interest. And one of the things that I think this might come from, again, in-group reciprocity, right? To what degree this is, you need to understand the role of the interpreter. You need to understand the ethics of the interpreter. You need to understand about deaf people. There was a lot of dialogue about our concerns as professionals that people on the outside get it about our in-group. And while that may be noble in lots of ways, oh, it's important to have education. It may not necessarily be important for that individual, except in that given moment, for them to understand this component of it. So a lot of our concern for education and justice and access actually makes us sound a little bit insular and not willing to say, what do you as the professional in this given moment need to understand about my job or this individual so that all of us can do what we need to get done here? And again, that's a very different reasoning approach than is, you need to understand about deaf people, and you need to understand about language and sign language and how different it is, and interpreters and et cetera. There's a potential for interpreters to understand and use language of principled reasoning, but it was almost always activated when it was language and culture specifically targeted. When it was obvious in the scenario that there was a language issue, and I'll give you an example. One of the scenarios that had to do with specifically language was a deaf person was in an evaluation, a psychologist was doing a court-ordered evaluation, and the deaf person signed this as a sign name for their father. And when the psychologist asked the deaf person, what's your father's name, spell it out for me, he said, oh, I don't know how to spell it. And the psychologist said, oh, interesting, he doesn't know his father's name. And so that scenario targeted everybody to say, no, 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 it's not that he doesn't know his father's name, it's that that's a cultural thing. So they went all post-conventional when it was obvious that it had to do with language and culture. The problem is that blinded them too, because it could have been that he didn't know his father's name. It could have been that 2 days ago he did know his father's name, but there's something wrong now. So all the interpreters jumped to reasoning in this way that we want them to reason to, but it also blinded them to other potential reasons. It's not that, this is the same thing as spelling the name out, they would say, in English. No, that's not. It's not the same thing. But because they were so compelled by language and culture being sort of the exact same thing, it didn't allow them to be careful about the words they chose to express their moral reasoning. So the final bullet point says there's a need for moral education, one that uses normative ethical language, principled thinking. How can we begin to change the way we talk about ethics that looks at things about collaboration and values and making sure that we're finding ways in which we as interpreters, when we walk into situations, understand the values of that setting so that we can figure out how best we can collaborate with individuals within that setting, and aiming for and imagining success as full reciprocity as opposed to imagining success as our in-group got what it wanted. And that would be a very different approach to ethics. I'm going to be summing up here and opening it up for questions in just one second. I just want to add that a whole other chapter looks at this data through REST's other unique contribution to the field of moral reasoning, and that is what's referred to as his four-component model. Moral judgment, which is the second in the line, is what we've been focusing on, how it is people come to judge what is right. Okay? But what REST suggested is before you get to moral judgment, you have to be able to interpret what's happening correctly. Otherwise, your judgment really doesn't matter. If you've misinterpreted what's happening, then you really can't come up with a good or right decision. He also proposed that you can come up with a good and right decision based on an accurate interpretation, but you're compelled to do something different because you're afraid of getting in trouble, or because somebody is watching you and someone's going to, etc. So it's called moral motivation, the ability to stick with the decision that you think is morally right. And then the final of those is moral implementation, and that is about the courage and the ability to actually follow through and find even sometimes just logistically feasible opportunities to employ your decision of what you think is right action. And then I go on to talk about other ways in which educational opportunities could seek to develop for interpreters not just their moral judgment, but their moral sensitivity, their moral motivation, and certainly in some instances, their moral implementation. Moral sensitivity in my PhD is covered extensively because when they read the scenarios, as I've given examples here, they decided they knew what was going on. In the cancer example, they decided the family was trying to keep information from this poor deaf person who didn't have the information, and the medical staff had no idea what was happening. That's the way they set forth. Nobody in my sample said, except for one person who said, I want to know where the family's coming from, was the one person who made that comment. Except for that one comment, most people imagined it's a sinister plan. The family has a sinister plan. And that's a real concern, I think, when interpreters look through the lens of hearing people have got it out for deaf people, and I'm going to make sure that doesn't happen. And that sort of cloudedness can cause, I think, problems with moral sensitivity. That's it for me in terms of that data. I'd like to open it up for questions and comments.
Does the interpreter need a break?
Does the interpreter
need a break? Okay, are you sure? Okay, well, should we shut down the live stream? Mm-hmm.